Hi, everyone. Welcome to the fourth webinar hosted by HEI Energy on human exposure research in a cyclical industry. Today, we have a very exciting lineup of speakers to talk about abandoned and orphaned oil and natural gas wells. Now, I see that we're having quite a few participants streaming in right now, so I'll just quickly go over who will be speaking today and some housekeeping items and logistics for the webinar today. So first up, we have Luke Plant, who will be talking about well plugging operations and challenges. Next up, we have Sarah Solomon, who will be speaking about the science policy interface. Then we have Lori Rotenberry, who will talk about state oversight and progress. After that, we will have Natalie Peckney, who will tell us more about her research on identifying and quantifying emissions from abandoned and orphaned oil and gas wells. And then finally, Peter McMahon, who will be speaking about linking methane in groundwater to abandoned gas wells in Colorado specifically. And then please feel free to put your questions in the Q&A for hopefully a lively panel discussion at the end of this session. And so that you all know, you will be muted with no audio for the duration of the webinar, but you can use the Q&A function to submit your questions and upvote questions from other participants to match your own question. This webinar will be recorded and posted on our website. Feel free to send us a chat if you experience any logistical difficulties that we might be able to help with. And then at the end, we ask that you please complete a post-webinar survey. We really appreciate your feedback on this. And we will also send an email about this tomorrow. So a little bit about HEI Energy. This is a new national research program. HEI is an independent nonprofit corporation chartered to provide policy relevant, high quality and impartial science, funded jointly by government and oil and natural gas industry and occasionally private foundations. HEI Energy funds research that is selected, conducted, overseen, and reviewed independently of those sponsors. And this new research program is overseen by the Energy Research Committee, which is comprised of internally recognized experts in one or more topics relevant to the research program. So with that, I would like to introduce the first speaker, Luke Plants. Luke Plants serves as Chief Operating Officer of Plants and Goodwin, a plug and abandonment contractor located in Northern Pennsylvania. And as a third generation business owner, Luke is responsible for staffing and training qualified plugging crews, coordinating third party services and interfacing with a wide range of stakeholders to tackle some of the most challenging plugging and abandonment projects in the Appalachian Basin. Luke, we are looking forward to your talk and I can see your slides. Thank you for that. The floor is yours.
Great. Thank you, Elise. Great to be here with everybody today, even virtually. This is a subject that's very near and dear to my heart. As Elise mentioned, I help operate a multi-generational family business. We've been in the space for roughly 50 years now, and we plug everything from sort of modern shale gas, Marcellus and Utica wells here in the Northeast United States, all the way back to wells that were drilled around the turn of the 20th century. So really some full spectrum kind of plugging operations. And leading off today, what I'm going to try to do is explain the actual step-by-step plugging procedure in order to provide maybe some color and context for my co-presenters that will talk a lot more about things like methane emissions, groundwater contamination, how we identify orphaned wells, how we locate them. So the way that I would like to provide some of that context is first through understanding, not to insult anyone's intelligence, but to actually understand how wells are constructed and how that construction has changed over time, how drilling and completions technology has evolved over time throughout the United States, and how I'm going to kind of create a dichotomy between a more modern well and a legacy well, since different technologies were used throughout the eras, different plugging techniques have to be used to now decommission these wells. So I'm gonna go through that a little bit. And finally, I'll put a bow on this by just talking briefly about some of the downhole challenges to plugging legacy wells, because that will be most pertinent to when you're thinking about abandoned and orphaned wells. Most of them are of a much older vintage. So I would like to explain that a little bit. And again, just as a sort of a disclaimer, I am, you know, primarily based in the Northeast United States. Drilling activity here has been is much older than some other states and other regions. The regulatory environment is a little different. So some of the things that I'll go over might be different from region to region, but hopefully the general consensus or general ideas that I give you are pretty uniform, I would say, throughout the United States onshore anyways. So first, I kind of want to talk about how a modern oil or gas well is drilled. And this isn't necessarily, and this is a picture of a modern Marcellus drilling pad in Pennsylvania. It's not so much the newer technologies that are being used that I'm using to classify what a modern well looks like, but really the standardization from the drilling to completions to production processes that really took more of a strong national effect somewhere in the early to mid 1950s. So to explain that, I'm gonna use some cheap PowerPoint animations because I think it's easier to look at a picture and understand what somebody's talking about rather than just to describe it with text bubbles. So the first step would be you're gonna mobilize a drilling rig to your site. And you're going to drill a conductor hole. This would typically be between 20 and 26 inches in diameter, anywhere from 30 to 120 feet deep. Mainly the purpose just to keep the top of the well from caving in. So some conductor pipe is then lowered in and cemented back to surface. The next stage would be to drill in your surface casing. Lower surface casing into the hole and again cement it back to surface, primarily in order to isolate and protect the fresh water table as labeled here. Most modern wells now have an intermediate casing string, but it's just the same idea again. I'm going to skip right to our production hole. So this is usually cased with a 4.5 or 5.5 inch casing, all the way down to the targeted hydrocarbon producing formation or formations that the driller is looking to extract from. And this casing may or may not be cemented back to surface. This is kind of at an engineer's discretion in many ways. After this, you would perforate that casing with some explosive charges, and the infamous fracking process would take place where you, with high pressure, you pump water, sand, and chemicals into the formation in order to extract the hydrocarbons back out. And then production phase commences where oil and gas is brought to surface and then put into either a pipeline or a tank battery. So that's how a modern oil and gas well is drilled, but that is not how oil and gas wells were always drilled. So this is a picture from around the turn of a century with a homemade constructed cable tool rig. So these legacy wells that I'm describing, often the drilling was done with what would be considered glorified farm equipment. It was often pulled around by a team of mules. You sometimes don't have any conductor in these wells. They would drill in surface casing, but it often was not cemented. That's because if this well is a dud, a thrifty oil man might want to pull that casing back out and reuse it. As you can imagine, that makes for a nightmare when it comes time to plug a well that was left unplugged and all the casing has been removed from it. But often this would be the only string of casing in the well. And then you would be in open rock formation all the way down to the targeted formation that was wanting to be produced. Then a nitroglycerin charge would be set off many cases here, and the well would have to be cleaned back out with the cable tools. Also, a packer might be set in the open hole down here. This is to isolate the zone. It would have production tubing attached to it. And again, same process, bringing the oil and gas to surface here. So as you can imagine, two different styles of construction, two different really, well, many different methods or procedures to plug, but just to kind of show you more of what a modern plugging job would look like. In this scenario, we would first pull any production tubing out of that well, if any existed, none in our animation here. Then we would mobilize a wireline unit that would set a mechanical bridge plug above the perforated casing. We would put some cement on top of that bridge plug. Here's something that's a little idiosyncratic to the Northeast, but regulations, Pennsylvania, Ohio, New York, state that any uncemented casing must be removed from the well. This differs a little bit from, say, Texas or Oklahoma. But we would run a cement bond log or a three-point tool to identify where the top of the cement was in our production casing. We would cut it and remove it from the well. And then we would proceed to cement all of our casing stubs and seats on the way out. The stub just being the spot where you cut the casing. A casing seat being anywhere where you made the step down into the next diameter hole. And then we would usually top hole this well with gravel or some other non-porous material. Many times they are cemented to surface. So this differs in many ways from how a legacy well is plugged. You can kind of see just from the surface how this looks different from the other picture. We're working around high voltage electric lines here. It is in the state DOT right of way. So we're working with diverting a lot of traffic. There's bystanders. You can see a house is nearby. So there's elements at the surface that make this a lot more challenging. But from a downhole perspective, this is how I would approach this plugging job. So assuming that we have something like 3-inch tube production tubing to surface, you would want to run maybe a smaller diameter pipe, like a 1-inch tubing down through the packer in order to get a bottom hole plug across that producing formation. I would then cut the tubing, remove it from the well using wire line, and then cement on top of the packer and across any other oil or gas producing formations on my way out. Because remember, this is all open hole. There's no casing in this well. And then finally, cement my casing seat plug here and finish it off. Now, there are challenges with this. And a lot of it is because of the way that certain regulations are written. A lot of it is because folks don't understand what time does to the materials inside these wells. But if the purpose of plugging is to shut off the vertical movement of fluid in the wellbore annulus, then the very first step should be to try to get cement across that producing formation. Often this is not the case. Often somebody will try to pull this packer first because a state regulation might say all uncemented materials must be removed from the well. Well, that packer often has been sitting there in that rock for 100 years. It has become a part of the well that is not going to be removed. Meanwhile, the reverse effect has happened on the production tubing, where it's become very brittle and paper thin in certain spots. So the first attempt you make to pull this packer will often result in you pulling the tubing apart. So now you have oil or gas leaking to surface, but no way to get back to the bottom of the well. So this is where you usually have to start trying to fish the tubing. And as you fish, because it is brittle, it just comes apart in very small chunks. This could take several weeks or several months. Maybe no progress is being made. So then you usually switch to a carbide mill of some sort with a power swivel to turn it downhole. This is meant to drill up the tubing that's left in the well and hopefully get down where you could drill the packer out. Often what happens here, small tubing inside a large open hole, you're going to get kicked off to the side and oftentimes begin drilling a new hole altogether. After several months and several hundred thousand dollars, people will often just try to cement the well here, but by placing that cement plug up the hole where you're not shutting it off at the original formation, this is often where you get a gas cut cement plug, meaning that it did not have time to properly cure, reach compressive strength before a natural gas flow has cut through your cement, and it is as effective as if it hadn't been placed there at all. So then this has to be drilled out and attempt to be reset. So these are a few of the problems I think that are associated with plugging these sorts of wells, and obviously different vintages, different eras, different constructions. It really means that you have to be part oil field historian as much as an engineer or a construction manager in order to really know how to tackle these problems. So I see I'm about out of time, and appreciate you all letting me present this information to you today. And we'll be happy to answer, I think, questions in the Q&A at the end.
So thanks so much for that very interesting presentation. I think we all learned a lot about what goes on with plugging and abandoning wells. Thank you very much for that. Next up is our second speaker of today. We'll leave the questions and answers for the panel discussion at the end. So please feel free, if you think of any other questions for Luke, to add those to the Q&A. And we'll get to those at the end. So our second speaker today is Sarah Solomon. Sarah Solomon is a program associate in the AAAS Center for Scientific Evidence and Public Issues. And previously, Sarah has served as a contractor in the EPA's Office of Research and Development. She was a member of the author team for the 2016 report, Hydraulic Fracturing for Oil and Gas, Impacts from the Hydraulic Fracturing Water Cycle on Drinking Water Resources in the United States, which was awarded EPA's gold medal for exceptional service. Sarah, thank you so much. I see your slide. Looking forward to your presentation. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Hi all, thank you to HEI for having me today and to my fellow presenters. It's an honor to be here with you all. As Elise said, my name is Sarah Solomon. I work for the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences Center for Scientific Evidence and Public Issues. AAAS is a nonpartisan, multidisciplinary scientific membership organization based in Washington, D.C. Many of you may know us as simply AAAS, our acronym. We are the publishers of the Science Family of Journals, a much beloved series. So I'm here today to provide an introduction to the issue of orphaned and improperly abandoned oil and gas wells. I want to start off by explaining some definitions you'll no doubt encounter as you read up on these issues and as you interact with other experts and stakeholders, all with vested interests. So first, what's an orphan well? Definitions vary across jurisdictions, but an orphan well is generally considered to be any oil or gas well without a solvent, financially responsible, legally responsible party to conduct proper plugging and site restoration. These wells become the responsibility of a state, tribe, or the federal government, depending on where they're located. So why is it important to distinguish an orphan well from an abandoned well? Abandonment is actually an industry process. A well is taken out of production and permanently closed and sealed according to safety and environmental standards. An abandoned well has been closed properly according to industry. Although the connotations of calling a well abandoned, of course, can be confusing for anyone who's not associated with industry. So how did we end up with so many of these wells? In the US, oil and gas exploration, production have taken place since the mid-1800s. A history of putting holes in the ground before regulation and before best practices means that many wells were left without being properly closed and sealed. It's likely that the majority of undocumented orphan wells are pre-regulatory and don't appear on most maps. These are the wells people will find in their backyards or stumble across in the woods. There are also modern orphan wells. Their former owners and or operators can no longer afford to close them. Market trends and the price of oil and gas dictate how many of these wells are in state portfolios and how many more of these wells regulators can expect to manage in the future. So, big question, why are these wells, whatever we call them, problematic? It's simple, really. Unplugged wells can leak harmful substances to the air, water, and soil, especially if they're old, as Luke described, and they're built before modern safety or integrity standards. These wells are often in poor condition, and it's important to remember that in addition to finding these wells and identifying what's coming out of them, we think about the associated environmental and human health effects, as well as the significant economic effects. These wells are costly to plug, ranging from thousands to millions of dollars per well. Cumulatively, we're talking about billions of dollars. That burden, as I said, falls on state regulators, state and federal land managers, tribal or indigenous authorities, all depending on where this well is located. So, you know, obviously Congress, federal agencies, state agencies are now exploring and adopting policies to address orphan wells and their potential impacts. The problem of these wells is determined by questions we're all trying to still get a handle on. Where are these wells? How many are there exactly? Who is responsible for plugging them? And really, who is paying to manage these wells? Different groups have estimated a range from tens of thousands to millions of orphaned or improperly abandoned wells. The Interstate Oil and Gas Compact Commission, EPA, and others all have different numbers based on which wells make it into their respective counts. A lot of this is obviously going to be based on documentation and it's definition dependent. So right now on screen is a map recently released by EDF. It's created in collaboration with McGill University. Together, they developed, using state-of-the-provided data, a data set of documented orphan wells for all those states that report them to visualize the distribution and density of wells eligible for closure. This was based on funding that was written into the REGROW Act, which obviously has since been absorbed into the bipartisan infrastructure deal. So on this map, you're seeing approximately 81,000 wells across 28 states. And all of this is as of this summer, so summer 2021. IOGCC, they're soon to update their report, which I'm sure we'll learn more about from Lori. And their data is based solely on self-reported numbers from states and the number of documented wells in their portfolios. So based on that count, there are about 56,000 wells. That's of 2019. If we count undocumented orphan wells, we're thinking that the number swells into the hundreds of thousands, if not over 1 million. And you know, conversely, EPA estimates that there are over 2 million inactive unplugged wells, of which documented orphan wells are only a subset. So estimates of wells without a financially stable owner or record probably hover around 1 million. But we also know that there's a large population of idle or active, but low or non-producing wells that operators may not be able to plug in the future. So right now, many states are modernizing their databases and confirming the location of some of these undocumented wells, as well as their legal status. We expect that these numbers will change soon. With all this in mind, there's still a ton of questions that regulators, decision makers, stakeholders, researchers, and others are asking about orphan and improperly abandoned wells and the related issues. All of this affects our understanding of the problem and what we might do to solve it. So we really want to know what are the true scope and scale of impacts. And these are some of the questions that are still up in the air where we can use help finding answers. Stuff like what is being released from these wells, how does it impact human health, what's the total volume of airborne emissions, how do those airborne emissions affect those that live nearby, how does the age and condition of a well change how much it costs to close that well, you know, what are the complicated and obviously expensive problems we might encounter once a well is added to a portfolio managed by a state or the federal government, how do we prioritize that list of wells? What conditions mean that that well is a greater risk and that it should be obviously jumped up that prioritization list? How do we find undocumented legacy wells? Once we find them, how do we determine that it's actually orphaned? You know, is there an owner? Can that owner be held responsible? So you may be wondering why and how my organization got involved in this topic. And it really all comes down to our mission statement. So the Epicenter was created a little over 3 years ago to ensure decision makers, and we sort of include everyone in that list from parents to policymakers, make sure that they have access to scientific evidence that informs and improves their decision-making processes and hopefully leads to better, safer outcomes. We routinely sort of scan the horizon for emerging issues at the intersection of science and society. Obviously, orphan and improperly abandoned wells was on our radar for some time when we were thinking about other energy development and transition products. But it became clear early on in the pandemic that orphaned and improperly abandoned wells were gaining attention they'd never really previously enjoyed. And so an understanding of the science related to these wells was going to be a crucial part of the policy conversation. So the Epicenter interacts with experts, stakeholders, decision makers, and other interested parties, as I said, in a number of ways, but we always customize our engagement based on the state of the science, who needs the information, and how best to simplify and communicate complex information to meet the needs of those that need it most. Sometimes this may be landowners or county boards. Other times it's regional water managers, or it could be legislators or other elected officials. We're always surveying the policy landscape to identify where decisions are being made and how we can get information relevant to those decisions in a timely manner. We found that convening experts and decision makers for a dialogue is one of the most productive ways of identifying everyone's respective needs. We disseminate information, we help answer questions, and from events like meetings, briefings, webinars, workshops, all types of events really, we create resources and then use follow-up events to disseminate those resources. Just to give an example related to orphan and improperly abandoned wells, in October 2020, we, the Epicenter, hosted a multidisciplinary workshop for scientific experts, regulators, industry decision makers, NGOs, and community organizations to explore where and how scientific evidence can more effectively be accessed and integrated into policy decisions. This event enabled scientists, policymakers, others to share their concerns and experiences, to think about research, public outreach, and policy solutions. It was obvious to us that there was a demonstrated need for more information. You know, what is the science? What is the state of the science? And it was obviously something that wasn't restricted to federal decision making. It was regional, state, county level. Everyone needed information about these wells. So in response, the Epicenter wrote a high-level overview of the issue, hosted a congressional briefing. We're also convening a small working group to continue the conversation. And these are places where we can always use more expertise and engagement. Obviously, our process is iterative and ever-evolving. There are ample opportunities for you as a member of the audience to get involved, and we welcome an opportunity to explore with you where and how you'd like to engage. All that said, thank you for your attention, and I look forward to answering questions during the discussion.
Thanks so much, Sarah, for that great presentation. I think you raised a lot of great questions that I think many of us in the audience are thinking about ourselves. So if anyone has any questions for specifically for Sarah potentially the role of what AAAS is doing in this issue, please feel free to add those to the Q&A and we will get to those at the end. Next up is our third speaker of today, Lori Rotenberry. Thank you so much for being here. Lori is Executive Director of the Interstate Oil and Gas Compact Commission, a government organization of oil and gas producing states. And we just, in the previous talk, we heard a little bit about IOGCC already. So at IOGCC, Lori serves the governors and regulators of 31 member states and 7 associate member states. And her previous service to the states included leadership roles at the oil and gas regulatory agencies in Texas, New Mexico, and Oklahoma. Lori, thanks. I can see your slides. So the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate the opportunity to join this group here today to talk about a topic that is near and dear to the hearts of the state members of the Interstate Oil and Gas Compact Commission. Just briefly, the IOGCC is a government organization of the oil and gas producing states. It's where the states come together to grapple with various oil and gas issues, including through the years, the issue of idle and orphan oil and gas wells. The IOGCC has published reports spanning several decades on this topic. Most recently, as Sarah mentioned, IOGCC updated its information in 2019, including data on orphan well inventories and orphan well plugging activities for 2018, as well as state-by-state summaries of the different program elements involved in managing orphan wells, including financial assurance requirements, requirements for idle well management, the establishment of plugging funds, innovations and incentives offered by the states, as well as areas for further work. That work has continued, and as Sarah mentioned, IOGCC is in the process of updating the idle and orphan well report to include data for 2019 and 2020, as well as dive into some of the areas for further work in a little more detail. This report will be released in December. I ask that you stay tuned for that report, and I'm going to share some preliminary data with you for this webinar in just a moment. I do ask that you hold off citing that information. We're in the final stages of verifying the data in the report and want to be able to stand by everything that we include in the report as representative of the information that the states have available at the moment on this important topic. But that being said, I do have some preliminary data to share with you. This particular very simple pie chart shows the documented wells drilled and not plugged. A couple of things to note. First, we have not reported on the plugged wells at this point, other than plugged orphaned wells. Our information on wells in state inventories focuses on the wells that have been drilled but have not yet been plugged. Secondly, note that we're talking about documented wells. The definition of a documented well from our perspective is a well that has a drilling report, a completion report, an inspection report, or some other record establishing to the satisfaction of the state that the well actually exists. This data does not include, or this chart does not reflect estimates of the number of undocumented wells. The undocumented wells are the wells that the states have some reason to believe exists, but the state needs to do more work to verify the existence of that well. this chart does not cover undocumented wells. There will be some estimates in the report from some states on the numbers of undocumented wells. Third, I wanted to point out here, I had hoped in this preliminary chart to give you some information about the total number of idle wells. We're still working with several states to refine that data point. And so I didn't include that information in the chart, although in 2018, the states reported about 200,000 idle wells. That would be another slice out of this pie. But in summary, there's a total of about 1.6 million documented wells that have been drilled and not plugged, of which as of December 31st, 2020, the states reported 92,170 orphan wells. And you might ask for a little more detail on that 92,000 number, especially first of all, note it does exceed the number that was in the 2019 report. In other words, the number that was reported as of December 31st, 2018, that number was about 57,000. The number has risen. If you'll look on this chart, what we've shown here are the numbers in the 10 states that have the most orphan wells currently. And we've lumped the remaining 22 states that we're reporting into one set of bars, one at the far right. Most of the increase you can see is attributable to the new reports from the state of Pennsylvania. There are some other states as well, though, that have been doing work to verify their inventory of orphan wells and have increased their estimates or their numbers for the numbers of documented orphan wells, including some of the states that are included in the remaining 22 states columns at the right of the chart. I should point out that some of the increase is related to recent bankruptcies, particularly in light of the events of last year where the industry struggled through at the effects of the pandemic, as well as the effects of an oil price collapse related to some international activities. But most of the increase that you're seeing reflected in this table relates instead to the work that the states have been doing to clean up their databases, to actually investigate the estimated undocumented well categories and document the existence of some of those wells. And then also some of them are doing research in the field using drones and other techniques to identify the documented orphan wells. So this is the number as of the end of 2020. I also wanted to briefly show you the information that will be published concerning well plugging activity. Over the last 3 years, there have been a total of 72,000 wells plugged. Most of those wells are plugged by industry. Those are those other wells in the gray bar. Most of those wells are plugged by industry, but 9,700 of them have been plugged by the states using various sources of funding. Moving on to the quick discussion of the various sources of funding, I just wanted to note, first of all, terminology is key. I'm not going to spend time on this slide, but we don't use the term abandoned wells because so many people use it in so many different ways. We recommend against using it, but if you do use it, make sure that you define the term clearly. I also wanted to highlight that as of December 31st, 2020, the states have plugged 77,890 orphan wells. And by now that number actually tops 80,000, just based on what we know about the plugging works that the states are doing. I wanted to say briefly that the IOGCC made recommendations to Congress during the development of the REGROW Act. And the main recommendation was to recognize and support the capacity of the existing state programs. Don't try to superimpose a federal program on the state programs, but help support the state programs through the provision of funding, which will accelerate the fogging work that's being done by the states. As Sarah mentioned, the Regrow Act was included in the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, Section 40601. It provides over $4.7 billion for plugging of orphaned wells, of which over $4.2 billion is appropriated for grants to states. There are three types of grants. I'm not going to go into the details of those. I've got some information here in the slides with the breakdowns and some of the basic application requirements and criteria. You can look at those later if you're interested. I want to slip on through these slides and hit on the slide at the very end, which concerns the allowable uses of the state grant money under the Regrow Act. And this is laid out in Section 349C2. First of all, this money is for orphan wells on state or private lands. There are separate appropriations for the orphan wells on federal lands and tribal lands in the legislation. So this money that's going to the state grants is for the wells on state or private lands. The allowable uses are listed here. Several of these relate to the health impacts of orphan wells. And so I wanted to point that out in particular for this group. Of course, the main purpose of the funding is to plug orphan wells and reclaim and remediate the adjacent lands and the associated facilities. But there are other activities listed here that include ranking orphan wells based on public health and safety. They include identifying and characterizing undocumented orphan wells, measuring and tracking emissions of gases and contamination of water, identifying and addressing the environmental justice, the impact on environmental justice communities, that's included here. All of these things relate directly to the kind of work that I understand HEI Energy is looking at doing. So I wanted to highlight that for you. And with that, I will conclude my remarks and look forward to answering questions during the panel discussion.
All right, thanks so much for that wonderful presentation. I think that really provided us all with some insights in sort of the broader scale efforts and looking at these types of wells that, you brought up a very interesting point about the terminology as well in how we're all using the term abandoned wells. So our final two speakers will be talking about their research related to these types of wells. And first up is Natalie Peckney. Natalie Peckney is an environmental engineer on the geoanalysis and monitoring team at the National Energy Technology Laboratory's Research and Innovation Center. She's the technical portfolio lead for NETL's Natural Gas Infrastructure Program. And her research focuses on quantifying greenhouse gas and other gaseous emissions from components and processes within the natural gas and oil supply chain. Natalie, thank you. I can see your slides, so the floor is yours. Sorry, Natalie, you're muted.
So sorry. You'd think I'd know by now to unmute. Thanks so much to HEI Energy for the opportunity to speak to you all today about the research that we've been doing regarding abandoned and orphaned oil and gas wells at NETL. So I'll just kind of briefly talk a little bit about some background information about methane emissions from abandoned oil and gas wells, orphaned wells. Sarah and Lori both did a very good job of kind of describing some of the issues with terminology. I'll probably be sticking mostly to the EPA's definition for abandoned oil and gas wells for my presentation. But every year the EPA comes out with their annual greenhouse gas inventory, where emissions of methane and other greenhouse gases are reported for various sources across the country. And the most recent inventory in 2021 that was published in April reported methane emissions from the energy sector. You can see on the pie chart on the left. You can see the biggest chunk of that pie is from natural gas systems at over 60%. And so the pie chart on the right further breaks that down into some of the actual source categories within the natural gas system. But if you look at the pie chart on the left, at the small slice of the yellow piece of pie there, that's abandoned oil and gas wells. So at this time, the current estimate of methane emissions from abandoned oil and gas wells is only about 3%. Of the methane emissions that are coming from the energy sector. So this is not actually a huge source of methane emissions. However, it is a source that we know how to mitigate. I'll kind of skip over this a little bit because we've already talked about definitions, but again, I'll just point out that the definition I'm going to use is the same as what the EPA considers, which is kind of an all-encompassing term for all of these wells. And the way that the EPA estimates methane emissions from the wells is by looking at an average emission rate or a mass of methane coming from a typical well, and then multiplying that by the total number of wells. So you have an emissions factor times an activity level, and that gives you the total methane emission. There's definitely significant uncertainty in both the emissions factors in the activity levels. So at NETL, we've been working on ways to address that uncertainty to try to decrease it. Currently in the greenhouse gas inventory, the emissions factors data are based on some studies that have been done in the past 5 or 10 years about abandoned oil and gas wells in different regions, led by Drs. Mary Kang and Amy Townsend Small. If you look at the blue dots, that shows the regions in which the samples were collected at several wells. And I just want to point out the number of wells represented in these studies. You can see that there were 5 wells sampled here, 10 wells sampled there, 16. I think the highest number we see is 87 wells. So these are really small numbers, actually, when you consider that the total population of wells across the country is estimated by the EPA to be around 3.4 million. So really, we're just kind of scratching the surface at understanding how much methane could potentially be leaking out of these wells. At NETL, we've developed some techniques for locating abandoned wells, which can be a real challenge. There are definitely a large number of undocumented wells if you consider that drilling has started in the mid-1800s. So you can imagine that early records might be really inaccurate or vague or just don't exist. So there are quite a few wells out there that we aren't clear on their location. And so we've developed techniques using magnetic surveys to locate wells. Because a well with metallic casing is oriented vertically, it's perpendicular to the Earth's magnetic field. So when you survey an area, like in a grid with a magnetometer, you can see a magnetic monopole signature that will pinpoint the location of a well. So you can see in the picture, we've done this just on the ground, walking surveys, which can be really challenging in areas where there's dense foliage, as you can imagine. When we find a well, sometimes there's nothing there left at the surface. It may have been casing cut off at ground level. Maybe it's buried. Sometimes you have to excavate a little bit or even a lot. But these methods work really well to locate wells, and we've since adapted them for use on manned helicopter surveys, where you can cover a large amount of area at once, and also with drones, which is a lot cheaper than a manned helicopter, and you still get the same accuracy of being able to find wells. So these magnetic techniques are very useful for being able to locate abandoned wells. And you can see that blue map there shows a typical result of an aerial magnetic survey, where you fly an area in grid formation and you come up with this map of so-called hotspots with magnetic anomalies, which then you can go out on the ground and visit, go to those coordinates and see if you can verify the location of a well. So over the years at NETL, we've done this in quite a few areas. And we've realized that when we do these surveys, we are finding a significant number of undocumented wells. It's typically somewhere between 46 to 59% more wells that we find than what were recorded in state and national databases for that area. So we thought about how to use this information to then interpolate what could the total number of wells be, knowing that there's such a large proportion of undocumented wells. So we did a statistical analysis and came up with estimates for the total number of wells in Pennsylvania and Wyoming, for which we had the most magnetic surveys completed. And then we extrapolated also to the entire US. So our results showed that our estimate is something like 6 million wells with 1.16 designated as abandoned. And those are some pretty large numbers with very large uncertainty still, even knowing that we've been able to use our magnetic survey data to try to reduce the uncertainty in how many wells there are. So although we have these estimates, there's still very high uncertainty, and continuing to do the magnetic surveys will help us drive down that uncertainty. So now I'll describe to you our efforts to quantify the amount of methane that might be coming from an abandoned or orphaned well. We use various approaches to collect this information. When we started this work, there really was, to our knowledge, no one had done it before. There were no data out there. So we came up with a few different approaches over the years for quantifying emissions from wells. One is to use a laser-based sensor. You can see the young woman on the right pointing a laser at a well. This is more of a qualitative assessment. It gives us the concentration of methane in the air between the sensor and whatever the laser is hitting. So we can use this laser-based approach to see if there are significant emissions of methane coming from the well, but not necessarily to quantify an emission rate. We've used optical gas imaging, using an infrared camera to view the well and to be able to see any emissions that could potentially be coming from it. Again, this is a qualitative approach. It doesn't give us an emission rate, but it's really helpful for wells in which there might be an intact wellhead where there's a lot of different flanges and pipes coming off and a lot of potential leak points. So using the infrared camera, we can potentially see specifically where the leak is coming from, and then we can focus our measurements on that. And then you can see in the picture on the right, the high flow sampler. This has kind of become the workhorse for us for measuring emissions because this instrument does give us a methane flow rate. It draws a really large volume of air, and either using thermal conductivity or catalytic oxidation, it can yield the methane flow rate coming from the well. And so with the high flow sampler, we get quantitative information about the methane emission rate, and it's nice and field portable. We can carry it in a backpack. We always think it kind of looks like Ghostbusters with the backpack and the hose where you're sucking in the sample, and it works quite well. And then lastly, we have taken some gas samples from some of the wells to take back to the laboratory and analyze for gas composition. So all of these approaches together we've used to quantify emissions from wells. And I know this slide is pretty busy with a lot of words, but I'll distill it down for you. And you have these numbers or this information if you'd like to review it later. But we've done studies in Pennsylvania, Oklahoma, Kentucky to date. And we have some future campaigns planned for other areas. In Pennsylvania, we've looked at two different state parks and measured emissions from wells there. And most of them are unplugged, some are plugged. From the unplugged wells, we got an average emission rate for Hillman State Park, which is close to the Pittsburgh airport, of 0.7 kilograms of methane per day. And then at Oil Creek State Park, which is in the area in Pennsylvania close to where the country's first oil well was drilled. So this is really early development. We kind of got close to half and half plugged versus unplugged. And the unplugged wells emission rate was a little lower than what we saw at Hillman State Park, but well within the bounds of uncertainty. So kind of similar results for those two areas in Pennsylvania. None of the plugged wells that we looked at in Oil Creek State Park were leaking. In Oklahoma, we visited 179 wells, 20 of which were plugged. And there we found an average emission rate for the unplugged wells to be 0.065 kilograms of methane per day. So that's significantly lower than what we saw in Pennsylvania. It is a statistically significantly different number. So that's interesting. It suggests there could be regional differences in average emission rates. And then interestingly enough, for the plugged wells that we measured, none of them were leaking except for one, but that one well was leaking at such a high emission rate, it was higher than any of the other unplugged wells that we visited. So this is a really good illustration at how emissions distributions from sources in the natural gas sector, like abandoned and orphaned oil and gas wells, tend to follow a distribution that's skewed by super emitters. So we call it a fat-tailed distribution because most of the wells are emitting very small quantities or none at all, but then you have these small handful of wells that are emitting, you know, vastly higher emissions. So in this case, that the fact that we had one super emitter in the population of plugged wells that we measured, it resulted in an average emission rate for the plugged wells being higher for unplugged. So really hard to characterize a source category like this with a fat tail distribution by just using averages to represent the whole sample population if you don't have a good handle on how many super emitters there could be and just how high their emissions are. In Kentucky, we got started taking some samples there, but we got interrupted by the COVID pandemic. So I'll just say our results there are preliminary, but the average emission rate that we're seeing for the unplugged wells there is similar in magnitude to what we saw in Oklahoma. So again, you know, potentially Appalachia versus other regions, maybe there's some regional differences there. So we'll be continuing to do measurements over the next few years at other regions. We're also hoping that as more data are collected, we can maybe have more distinctions other than just plugged versus unplugged or regional. Maybe there's gas versus oil or some other parameters like age of the well, depth of the well, et cetera, that might allow us to kind of predict emissions. And overall, what we're attempting to achieve here with collecting this information, we like to share it with state agencies or operators that need to know the location of wells and if they're leaking or not, so that overall we can come up with risk characterizations that then inform effective mitigation strategies. With the resources that are available, which wells do you maybe want to target first for plugging and abandonment? This is just a graphical representation of the results for our Oklahoma field campaigns. You can see in the pie chart the proportion of wells that were unplugged in the yellow and blue, and the smaller amount that were plugged in the orange and gray. And then that little slice of gray colored pie, that's one plugged well that was leaking, just a small number in that sample population. But then if you look at the simple graph on the right of the average emission rate, you can see that that one super emitter resulted in an average emission rate for plugged wells that was higher than unplugged, surprisingly.
Natalie, just a comment that we're reaching the end of the time for your presentation. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, really this last slide here. So I don't expect you to read this all the numbers in this table, but this just gives an idea of gas composition. I wanted to touch a little bit on potential exposure risk. All of the wells that we've measured from to date have really low emission rates with respect to hazards. They're well below explosive limits. And so there is some concern though that heavier hydrocarbons that present more of a human health risk might be present. So when we've looked at gas composition, and this is just showing results for 10 wells, although we have data for quite a few more. If you look at the top row for methane, you could see that the normalized percentage of the gas is almost all methane, at least 95%, sometimes up to 99%. So really, when we're talking about exposure from the gases coming from abandoned wells, most of it is going to be related to exposure to methane. Other gases that were present that we may or may not have been able to detect, like ethane, propane, butane, pentane, were present in trace amounts. And so that would lead to the assumption that heavier hydrocarbons like BTEX compounds would be present in even smaller proportions. And then we also look at stable carbon isotopic signature just to make sure that the methane that we're measuring is in fact thermogenic, meaning it's coming from deep underground, versus biogenic, that's more from surface processes like the methane you might see coming from wetlands, for instance. So all the blue dots are clustered close to the kind of the area that we would classify as thermogenic. So quickly, the conclusions, kind of the takeaways here, is that abandoned wells are still a pretty small source in comparison to other sources in the energy sector, but there are very large uncertainties that remain. And even just determining the number of wells is difficult due to incomplete records, although we've shown that using magnetic surveys is a useful technique for finding wells. We're seeing that emissions from wells can vary widely. Certainly there's differences between plugged and unplugged, maybe regional differences, but definitely we need more data to determine if there are other factors too that could influence emissions. And lastly, the leaking gas is more than 95% methane. So not seeing a lot of contribution from other gases in the composition. At NETL, we've started a citizen science program that you might be interested in. I believe these slides will be shared with you later, so you can click on the link at the top there. But basically, we're asking if anyone finds a well, maybe there's one in their backyard or they encounter it somewhere, you can take a picture, use your phone to record coordinates and upload that information to the website. And that'll help us determine if the well is already in a database, if it's undocumented, do we want to visit it to do a risk assessment, measure emissions from it, et cetera. So just put that out there if anyone wants to participate. Feel free to go in that link and contribute if you can. All right, well, thank you very much. And I look forward to questions at the end of the webinar.
Thanks so much, Natalie. With that, we're gonna move on to our final speaker of today, Peter McMahon. Peter is a research hydrologist with the US Geological Survey, Colorado Water Science Center. And he has more than 35 years of experience conducting groundwater quality studies across the United States. And today he will be talking about specifically Colorado. Peter, I see your first slide. Looking forward to your presentation.
Great. Thanks, Elise. And hello, everyone. Today I'm going to show an example from Colorado where we've linked methane and groundwater to an abandoned gas well. So one of the challenges with stray gas contamination in groundwater is distinguishing between naturally occurring methane and methane from hydrocarbon production activities. And so the purpose of my presentation is to illustrate how a multi-tracer approach helped us link methane and groundwater to an abandoned gas well. Our study area is the Piance Structural Basin in northwestern Colorado. And today's presentation is based on some work we published back in 2018. So if you want more detail on what I talk about today, you could find it in this publication. So I'm gonna focus this talk on one of the monitoring areas in our study area. At this particular site, we have three monitoring wells. 13U is a shallow monitoring well. 13A is an intermediate depth monitoring well, and 13B is a deep monitoring well. And we began sampling these wells back in 2018 and continued sampling into 2017. And you can see some of the data in the plots below the picture. The highest methane concentrations occur in the deep well, quite high concentrations that are above the methane saturation level. The next highest concentrations occur in the shallow well, 13U. Those concentrations are around 15 to 20 milligrams per liter. And quite low methane concentrations in the intermediate depth well, 13A. As our previous speaker mentioned, stable carbon isotopes of methane can be used to distinguish methane sources. It turns out that those high methane concentrations in the deep well, 13B, are due to biogenic gas production within the aquifer itself. However, the methane concentrations in the shallowest well, 13U, that methane is thermogenic in origin. So it's methane that was produced much deeper in the geologic section than the biogenic gas. And then 13A with the small amounts of methane appears to be a mix of biogenic and thermogenic gas. So it turns out that this site also has an abandoned gas well on it. That well is known as Sulphur Creek Number 1. It was drilled in 1956 and it was plugged and abandoned in 1990. It's 25 meters away from well 13U. And the next closest gas well to this particular site is about 400 meters away. So this is kind of a little expanded aerial view now. Site 13, which is the focus of this presentation, is shown by the blue dot. And then that gray circle you see is a 1 kilometer buffer around the study area. The black lines are show the locations of faults and fractures. So you can see there are a number of fracture zones located close to our study area, including one zone that's within about 400 to 500 meters of our study area. And then also shown on this slide are two additional abandoned gas wells. Those are shown by the brown diamonds. And there are 12 producing gas wells, which are shown by the overlapping gray boxes. So you can see there are a lot of potential sources for thermogenic gas in this area, two of which could be natural sources associated with the fracture zones. Those processes being things like gas-rich brine migration and free gas migration. And then there's also, of course, the leaky gas well hypothesis. So the question is, which of these processes accounts for the thermogenic gas in 13U, or is there more than one process going on? Just to give you a little bit more context for the study area, once again, 13U is the shallowest well. It's located about 25 meters below the water table. 13B is the deepest well, and there's a thick confining zone that separates 13B from the two shallower wells. That confining zone is referred to as the MZ zone. And importantly, there's a strong downward vertical hydraulic gradient from 13A to 13B, which indicates groundwater would have a tendency to move downward across that confining zone. And then there's a smaller upward hydraulic gradient from 13A to 13U. I mentioned 13U has thermogenic gas in it, and this plot on the right is similar to the one you saw in the previous talk, where we're plotting the ratio of methane to ethane plus propane versus the carbon isotope composition of the methane. And the 13U data are shown by the red circles, so those data plot within the thermogenic gas field. And then these little plus signs are samples of commercially produced natural gas in the basin. And you can see then that the gas in 13U looks compositionally similar to commercial production gas from the basin. Whereas the gas in 13B, which is shown up here, looks much more like biogenic gas that occurs in the aquifers. Okay, well, it turns out that we can rule out gas-rich brine migration as the source of the thermogenic gas. This plot on the right, shows methane concentrations versus chloride concentrations. If gas-rich brine migration were occurring, we would expect to see concentrations of methane and chloride to increase together, kind of in a direction towards the upper right. But in fact, the data for 13U, again shown in red, show that it has a similar chloride concentration to other samples from the shallow aquifer, which are shown by the green circles. So similar chloride, but unlike those other shallow samples, 13U has a much higher methane concentration. So another factor that helps us rule out gas-rich brine migration is the fact that we have this downward vertical hydraulic gradient across the confining zone. So we wouldn't expect to see deeper brines moving upward across this confining zone. So for those reasons, we've ruled out gas-rich brine migration as the source of the thermogenic methane in 13U. We've also ruled out free gas migration as the source of thermogenic methane. As I mentioned, 13B has quite high methane concentrations that exceed methane saturation levels. So we would expect to see free gas in 13B. In fact, when you run video logs in the well, you do indeed see free gas. And here I'm showing a screenshot from a tenth of a foot above the water table and another from 3 feet below the water table. And you can clearly see free gas present in 13B. So if this free gas was indeed moving upward to 13U, then you'd expect the carbon isotopic composition of methane in 13U to look similar to what is in 13B. But in fact, the isotopic data are very different. 13B has an isotopic composition of around -62 per mil. 13U is more like -35 per mil. And these differences are huge in isotopic space. So it's clear that the free gas in 13B isn't making its way up to 13U. And one reason for that is probably that this confining layer is an effective gas cap. Okay, so we've kind of ruled out two important natural sources. So how about gas migration from Sulphur Creek number one, which is located close to 13U? I'll note that in the paper, we also address the possibility of gas migration from those other gas wells that are within a kilometer of 13U. But in the interest of time, I'm just going to focus on Sulphur Creek number one in this presentation. So this plot on the, Sulphur Creek one was drilled in 1956. The plot on the left shows the well construction as it was prior to plug-in in 1990. So you had an open perforation down here through the production casing. You had some annular cement around the production casing that went up to about 1,250 meters. The top of gas in the formations is up around 300 meters. And we had about 1,000 meters of uncemented annular space around the production casing that was below top of gas. And so this uncemented annular space is very likely a migration pathway for free gas, as indicated by these dashed red lines. And then the depths of our three monitoring wells are shown over here by these blue squares. So this condition shown on the left occurred for 34 years prior to the plugging of this well. So that was at least three decades where gas migration could occur. And then after plugging in 1990, the picture looked like I'm showing on the right. Cement plug closed off the perforation. Two more shallower cement plugs were installed higher in the casing. And then there was some cement squeezed in the annular space, shown by these gray areas here and here. But the annular space below top of gas was not entirely plugged with cement. So there are still pathways for gas migration. And so this situation occurred for at least 20 years prior to when our monitoring began in 2010. And you can see from the methane versus time data for 13U that which started in 2010, methane concentrations in 13U persist at about the same concentrations. This indicates to us that either leakage continues in the plugged well, or the plugging has actually stopped leakage, but gas dissipation in the shallow aquifer is occurring really slowly, like on the order of decades. Either situation is not a good thing, of course. And I'll also note that the drilling and plugging of these wells was done according to regulations that existed at the time. And so what we see at this site just kind of further reinforces what we already know. And that is that older regulations, you know, in old gas wells are not necessarily protective of shallow groundwater quality.
Pete, I just wanted to let you know we're coming up close to time, and I wanted to make sure that we have some time for Q&A at the end. So just a heads up.
Thank you. So groundwater at the water table is oversaturated with methane compared to air saturated water. So the methane at that in that shallow aquifer is degassing to the unsaturated zone. But we don't detect methane emissions to the atmosphere using soil gas flux chambers around the plugged gas well. And this is most likely because the methane is being oxidized to carbon dioxide in the thick unsaturated zone. And so importantly, measurements of methane emissions at the land surface may not detect leaking gas wells if the leaks occur below deeper water tables. One of the things we're interested in is whether these kind of thick unsaturated zones are common near gas wells that were drilled and plugged around the same time as Sulphur Creek number one. So the plot on the upper left shows the number of oil and gas wells drilled in Colorado by decade, and the bottom plot shows the number of wells that were abandoned by decade in Colorado. And our analysis indicates that 75 to 85% of the wells drilled between 1920 and 1960 and wells plugged between 1920 and 1990 are in areas where the water table may be greater than 20 meters deep. And so these are areas where you may not be able to detect methane fluxes at the land surface. However, I'll note, this is my second to last slide, methane emissions to the atmosphere may not occur near the leaking well, but they could occur where groundwater discharges to nearby streams. And so this is another shot from our study area showing 13U up here to the north and the local discharge area, which is Black Sulphur Creek here, which is less than a kilometer away. So it'd be interesting to know whether methane emissions are occurring from Black Sulphur Creek. So I'll close with just a few take-home messages. The first is that multi-tracer approaches help us understand complex interactions between aquifers, hydrocarbon reservoirs, and oil and gas production activities. Measurements of methane emissions at land surface may not detect leaking gas wells if the leaks occur below deeper water tables. In Colorado, the majority of older gas wells appear to be in areas with deeper water tables. The methane may not be emitted to the atmosphere near the leaking wells in these areas, but it could be emitted when the groundwater discharges to nearby streams. And with that, I'll thank you for your time.
Pete, thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. I think you've given us all a lot to think about here. If I may ask all the speakers to turn on their cameras, and we will get to as many of the questions that were asked in the Q&A as we can during the remaining time. Please know that quite a few of the questions have already been answered. So thank you very much for that. We will start off with the first question. In terms of in regards to Natalie's talk, you mentioned super emitters. How would you define a super emitter, and what are some of the ways that that we might predict what a super emitting well might be?
So super emitters, this is not an issue that's unique to emissions from abandoned oil and gas wells. Most emission sources have a kind of distribution that follows this type of pattern. Even your vehicles, for instance, you know, most of them have emissions that are controlled, but then you have a few out on the road that don't, and you've seen them, the black smoke, etc. So the issue of super emitters is difficult to address when you're trying to quantify emissions across the whole population, the whole sample population. So, you know, the way the EPA is estimating emissions using the emissions factors, that's an average of emissions from abandoned oil and gas wells. There's a lot of uncertainty in those emissions factors, and that of course is driven by the presence of super emitters, and they're very hard to identify. So one thing that we're working on at NETL is trying to incorporate assessments through drone-based surveys to see if we can identify super emitters. So at the same time we'd be doing those magnetic surveys, we could potentially be identifying if there are super emitters. I think this will be a challenge because even though we would call an abandoned well a super emitter, the emissions from a super emitter are still relatively quite low when you consider that there's methane in background ambient air. And if you're trying to detect it from the height that the drone is flying, it might be difficult. So I think it'll be a challenge, but that's some research that we're going to be doing over the next couple years to see if we can further pin down super emitters.
Great, thank you. Next, we have a question for Lori. Lori, how would you say that that the plugging efforts are generally prioritized? Is there a standard risk ranking process in terms of prioritizing which wells need to be addressed first?
The states have priority ranking systems that I would say generally consider the same kinds of issues that were identified in the REGROW Act as elements that should be considered in ranking orphan wells for plugging and remediation. I would note that the Groundwater Protection Council currently is working on a module of the risk-based data management system that would support the states in their efforts to assess and assign priorities to orphan wells based on factors like impacts on public health and safety, environmental impacts, location with respect to communities, a large number of factors like that go into the ranking systems used by the states.
Great, thank you for that. Then we have a question for Luke, you talked about sort of these efforts to plug legacy wells, and that hasn't always been successful. But right now, we're using the current best practices to plug a well. What is the reasonable lifetime of that plug and cementing job? And would this ever need to be done again? Or is the corrosion of the cement plug not an issue?
Yeah, so that's a really great question. And there's a very strong push from people in sort of material science backgrounds to be researching something that maybe doesn't corrode like cement does as a plugging material. The problem is that the data on leaking plugged wells is flawed inherently because there was not a good standardized plugging procedure for decades and decades. It was simply get the well plugged as cheaply as possible. So in many cases, produced water that was coming out of these wells during the plugging process was being used to mix the cement slurry. So the plugs themselves were inadequate when they were placed in the well. In many cases, there were no oil and gas inspectors on site when these wells were plugged, no way to verify where the plugs are actually at. So what we're going off of is a piece of paper filed for the state capitol that says that, yes, this well was plugged properly and here are where all the plugs are. But it's really difficult to actually surmise whether cement is an inferior plugging material or whether we've just been plugging wells poorly for years and years and years.
Great, thanks, Luke. For Sarah, so you've mentioned that at AAAS, the epicenter is taking into account different stakeholders and how they can be involved in this science and policy process. So will the epicenter be involved in defining priority wells for remediation? So kind of touching upon the question for Lori as well, how does the epicenter fit in with that, or is there a different process involved there?
Yeah, thank you for that question. The epicenter is in the business of making sure that any decisions get made are informed by science. We're not prescriptive, so we're never going to go to a decision maker, no matter who that individual may be, and say, you need to do X, Y, and Z. Rather, we're going to say, this is the body of scientific literature upon which your decision can hinge. And these are the ways we think this, the body of literature ought to be incorporated. But in terms of helping states determine just what their conditions are for prioritization and how then to go about, moving through that list of prioritization, no, we most likely would not be involved. We have not been involved thus far, but you know, we would be happy to discuss with states and researchers who are working in this area just what they think the you know, most important factors might be, and then how those ought to get integrated. But we, as I said, we would never be prescriptive in that manner.
Thanks, Sarah. Then a question for you. So you've mentioned the multi-tracer approaches and all the different methods that you might be using to really identify where the leaks might be coming from. So how have you identified where these wells might be located? And in terms of different types of releases that might be entering the environment, are there other compounds other than methane that might be relevant for human health impacts?
With respect to the first part of the question, you know, we haven't done a systematic analysis of oil and gas wells to say that, okay, here's where we should be doing monitoring. It's, to this point, it's kind of been the exact opposite. It's like, well, here's where we've been funded to do monitoring. Are there any oil and gas wells that are problematic nearby? It would be really nice to do that kind of risk assessment that you was described by the in the question. You know, to you know, look at where high risk oil and gas wells might occur, and then go do you know, a really systematic monitoring approach to see what's going on. But that's not what's commonly occurs. In terms of other types of tracers that can be used, there are lots of them. You know, one of the big challenges in linking contamination from oil and gas activities to contamination in groundwater is really knowing what the composition of those oil and gas fluids is. I mean, the contamination is a mixing process, basically. And in order to kind of unravel that mixing process, you have to know what the composition of the end members is. You have to know what the composition of the formation water, or the produced water is. You have to know what the background composition of the groundwater is. And there's actually very little data on the composition, on complete chemical and isotopic analysis of produced waters, for example. And so, you know, typically we'll have methane concentration data or maybe chloride and bromide data, but, you know, produced waters are very complex waters. There's a lot more to the chemistry there. So one of the things we've been trying to do lately is do much more comprehensive analyses of produced waters and gases to better characterize that end member so that when we do find contamination in groundwater, we can better sort out what the mixing processes are. But some of those other things are, you know, obvious ones like BTEX compounds, benzene, toluene, and so on. Various trace elements, you know, like lithium and boron. You know, there's been recent talk about, well, maybe PFAS compounds are occurring in produced waters, you know, so maybe those are something that should be looked at. So there's lots of different things that could be looked at, but the effort is still in its infancy, I think, in that regard.
Thanks so much. I'm afraid that we're really coming up at the end of this session. I think we've heard five fantastic speakers today, and I would like to thank you all for sharing your wonderful work with us. Thank you to the participants, the webinar participants today, for asking so many insightful questions in the Q&A and in the chat today. And to the speakers, thank you for answering as many of those as possible as they were coming in. Some really great questions and answers that we've had here today. With that, I would like to thank you all, and please know that the webinars will be available on our website in the coming weeks, and please stay tuned for announcement of the future webinars, and please, if you can, take a few minutes to complete our post-webinar survey that will pop up at the end, and you will receive by email as well. So thank you all very much.